Hello ABC Latino Mundo Nómada followers. Today we are with Jimena Castria and Kyle Coppinger, a beautiful couple that decided to start that traveling dream that so many of us just dream about it. 3 years ago, they decided to take a year off from work and spend it traveling to Southeast Asia. Yes, you heard it right, 1 year off. Let's hear this beautiful story from them. Hi Jimena, hi Kyle, how are you today?
Good.
Why didn't you tell us a little bit about you and where did you live, where are you from, how old are you? What were you working on at that time?
Want to go first?
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah. So, Kyle Coppinger, I actually live in Seattle, Washington. That's where I grew up and spent most of my time. I worked in California for about 6 years. That's how I met Jimena. And, yeah, we decided to move back to Seattle for that last year, and we decided to take a year off after I moved, and we took off to Southeast Asia.
I was living in Seattle, working in marketing. You know, when you spend a few years at the same company, and you're just ready for some adventure. So
you're
that was
ready
it.
For that.
Yeah, I was really ready.
Where are you from?
I'm from Argentina.
You're from Argentina. Okay.
And I grew up in New York State.
How this idea of traveling for a year was born?
Oh my God.
We're both very adventurous people, and we traveled before we met each other. And I think traveling at a younger age, it's really put a seed in both of us. Jimena traveled in South America, I traveled in Europe. Actually spent some time in Europe as well. I spent some time in Japan for work, but I think we have that adventurous spirit, and when we got together, we met each other. We kind of just joked about it, then all of a sudden we're like, well, why can't we? Why can't we just do it, just take a year off? And that kind of, again, put that seed in us, and then we started planning, and it became a reality. And
yeah, it was really natural. I think that's it was just, you know, we knew that's what we wanted to do. We wanted to take advantage.
Yeah, big decision. Was it hard to quit your jobs, like make that decision of, okay, I'm going to quit today, and I'm just going to live for a year?
It was like 6 months between when we like knew we were going to do it and then when we actually were ready.
Yeah.
So, you know, at first we joked around and then we really made the decision and then the planning happened. So I think when it was really time, we were just so excited.
Right.
Yeah. And did you make a plan for when you came back? You were like, okay, in a year we're going to come back and we're going to do this. Or you just went off?
No, we just went off. I think a year was an arbitrary timeline. We knew that we wanted to travel, but, you know, this a year was maybe a bracket on where we didn't want to be, you know, shorter than a year, but we didn't know if we wanted to go longer than a year, so.
Yeah. And how did you choose the place where you go? Why Southeast Asia? Why no other place in the world?
I think it was somewhere we had never traveled, either of us, so it was just going to be something new and so culturally different than maybe going, you know, to Europe or South America where we have a connection. So the Asian culture was just completely different. We really wanted to experience that.
And how was that when you were there? Like that experience with the culture was like what you were expecting, or it was totally different? How was
that? Our first stop was in the Philippines, and we were there for a month. And so we left Seattle in January. And so we flew into the Philippines, and it's their summertime there. Mm-hmm. So we were just in the culture portion of it, and like the climate, and being exposed to that, we were kind of like, whoa, we're now in a tropical, you know, island. So yeah, that was kind of a shock for me, you know. But
yeah, how was the language? Like, it was hard to find like communicate that, or was easy? How was that?
It just depended. Like in the Philippines, everyone really spoke English very well.
Mm-hmm.
Then, you know, we traveled in a lot of places that didn't have large tourist communities, and then it was different, and there was not a lot of English speakers, like, you know, in some of the islands we visited, in Indonesia and in Vietnam, outside of the major cities, mm-hmm. there was not a lot of English speakers.
Okay. And did you make a travel plan before to go, like places to go, places to stay, maybe where to work if you were needing to work or something like that?
Yeah, so I before we left, I went to school and got my TESOL, which is teaching English as a second language. So I went to the college and did a quarter on that and then got that certificate. So I knew once we were over there, I wanted to teach English, not only for a second income while we were over there, but also, you know, to really dive into the culture and really learn with the locals. Because once, you know, we started doing that, then, you know, you get to learn the families, and then the other teachers will say, hey, come out with us, and then you get off the normal beaten path and the tourist path. And then you also get to be immersed in their language as well. So that was really important for us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Did you choose places to go before to go, or you just went and see what happened there?
We just had a plan really in the Philippines. That first month we were really organized, and then that pretty much stopped because it was just like, you just didn't know if you were really going to fall in love with the place and want to spend a long time there. So really after that first month, we just, you know, played everything by ear and just moved around really organically.
Yeah, and we also chased the climate as well.
That's true.
So we did know that the Philippines at the time that we were flying in, again, it was in that summer stage, so we wanted to go like where it's hot and nice, and then we'd fly. Then from there we went to Malaysia, and that was kind of the same, but a little bit cooler. And then we had to decide where we were going to go because of the climate.
Yeah, when monsoon season hits there, there's no reason to be there. It's so terrible, and there's flooding all the time, so it's time to move.
So it was a real adventure.
Yeah, but okay. To answer your question as far as the planning goes, yeah, you still had to plan once you went over there and where you wanted to go next.
Yeah.
You know, you could be, how we were, very organic, because traveling over there is very simple. It's very easy. Once you get over there, then, you know, going to country, you can travel very freely.
Okay, with this, I'm just thinking about one of the most important questions, budget. Like, how much money you think you were going to spend, and how much money you actually spent in this year?
Well, we spent a lot less money than we thought.
Okay.
I think that's the best
question. That's good news.
Yeah. You know, it really depended on what country we were, how much money we were spending. There are some countries that are just more expensive than others. But because we were working at the same time, we really didn't spend any money. So at the end, we kind of just came out
without spending money.
Yeah.
Which is great. And then another way you need to look at is, how are you traveling? Are you traveling and staying in hotels every night? Are you staying in 5-star hotels? Are you traveling by air, flying in? Mm-hmm. You taking buses? We did it on backpacks. We did it, what we call it, on a shoestring. So everything that we traveled in was on our backpacks. Mm-hmm. So all of our clothes, all of our food most of the time, you know, we did it
like the locals did. And so we primarily went to the restaurants and like the cafes that the locals would go to. So, you know, for an Indonesian, maybe they spend $1 or $2 a day. And so if you're eating kind of at these places and being, you know, staying in people's houses and, you know,
hostels,
things like that, it doesn't have to be, you know, $100 a day.
Yeah.
It can be just maybe $10 or $15 a
day. Between the both of us.
Yeah.
How easy is it to find accommodations, that type of accommodations?
It depends. Yeah. Sometimes there's a more of a struggle to find it, and that's because we were... You know, we'll say Vietnam, for instance. We did it on a motorcycle.
We
bought a motorcycle in the north, and then we traveled all the way up to the north, up into the border of China, and then all the way back down to Saigon, which is the southernmost by Cambodia. And that took us, we were there doing that all together for 90 days.
Mm-hmm.
So, but to answer your question, being up in the remote areas in the mountains, you know, and not being able to speak the language, it was really hard sometimes to find places. But you know what? We never slept on the road. We never slept.
Yeah.
You know, it always worked out.
Yeah, it always worked out. You know, sometimes you're just not in places that most people are backpacking to, because you have the freedom to go on your motorcycle anywhere. So you have to be a little more creative.
Yeah.
Go with the flow.
Yeah.
Those are saying pretty much. Just go with the flow.
Go with the flow. Okay. What countries did you visit in total? How many countries and which ones do you remember?
Yeah. So we started the Philippines, and then we went to Malaysia, and then Indonesia, and then back to Malaysia.
Then from Indonesia we flew to Vietnam.
From
Vietnam, then we went back to Malaysia, and then we flew back to Indonesia.
And then back to
Vietnam.
We did not take a very straight route. Yeah. But there would be things like friends would come visit us and they wanted to go do this. And we're like, oh yeah, that's a perfect excuse. We really loved it here.
Right.
We spent like one amazing beach that we fell in love with. We went back multiple times. So.
Yeah. How was transportation? I heard you were using a motorcycle, flying also. Lot. But how was in the town's transportation?
Terrible. Well, it was, we really like being autonomous, and it's when you're trying to take like these little buses and stuff, it's very hard because you don't know the language. And so if you're doing long distance buses from like major cities, it's easier.
Yes.
But within the cities themselves, it's very difficult.
It's very difficult to take a local bus. One, like she said, you might know where you want to go. Right, but the routes and the stops to get there in between, you might get, you know, kind of turned around, right? If that made sense. Yeah, so you might get off at one spot and have to transfer a bus to get to the next point, but
You really rely on the locals to kind of be like, here, and then you got to get out and you have a next person.
But again, it all worked out.
It always worked out.
Okay, so just thinking about that, I also want to make this question. Why you don't tell us a story that you always remember? Maybe something funny, maybe something not so much funny, or something that you always remember from the trip.
You know, during our motorcycle ride all the way on the north side of Vietnam, we, you know, didn't always have the best GPS service, and so you just kind of try to go by intuition where you thought the right turns were, where there was a lot of signaling, and not kind of get lost.
Which is half the fun, by the way, of getting lost.
Absolutely. So all the way on the north side of Vietnam, almost no one speaks English, by the way, all the way up there. So we're just kind of following a bunch of different routes, and we see some major roads, so we think, oh, okay, that's where we need to be. And we just keep going on these routes, and eventually we get to this area where there's a lot of trucks, and we're not sure what's going on, so we keep driving, and we see just a lot of activity, and we realize, wait, we probably shouldn't have gone that way. It's probably the wrong way, actually. And we decide, we turn around and come back, and there's you know, two gentlemen just standing there that clearly were guards. And we realize that we accidentally crossed the Chinese border without stopping.
So you were in China all of a sudden.
We were just in China all of a sudden. And then, of course, we come back. And right before crossing, we take a selfie in China, because why not? We're already there.
But they never asked you for passport.
No, I think they thought we were crazy or something. We're just two people on a motorcycle
with big
backpacks on and just going across, and it's like, I'm driving, I'm like, oh my goodness. And as soon as you get in there, you have the big Chinese flag and the star and everything, and you're like, oh my goodness, we're
in China.
And then how did you find life back in US when you get back?
I think we just were not ready to come back in some ways. You know, you're used to living. We had, our backpacks were 8 kilos, so they were very small, and we had really just one of everything you needed, and you'd go to grocery stores, and there would just be one option, and so you're just living a very simple, stress-free life. And then we came back, and you go to the grocery store, and there's like 20 million options of everything, and, you know, there's just so much noise, and so it was hard for the first few months to get back to your normal life, and feel like, oh my god, this is like so overwhelming sometimes.
Absolutely. That's a beautiful way to put it, because, you know, we're a big consumer nation here in America. I mean, that's just, nothing wrong with that. That's how we are. Over there, you know, when you go to the supermarket, like you said, or the local market, you know, what's in season is what you're going to eat. So you catch the fish whenever the fish is in season, or the bok choy or the lettuce or whatever, then that's what you're cooking. It's very simple, you know, no frozen foods or anything like that.
What did you do with your belongings when you were going to leave? Like, you had a house, you know, things in house. And what did you do with that before to leave?
We got rid of a lot of stuff.
Everything?
Yeah, almost everything. We kept like our kind of important things at Kyle's mom's house. I sent some to my parents. So we had been renting also, and I had like a really old car. So we didn't have like a lot of like investment into our things. So it was easy to kind of let it go.
It was easy to let it go. And when you were back, it was also easy to get everything again.
Yeah, very easy.
What you need, at least.
Yeah, very easy. And we also noticed that we didn't need as much as before we left. You know, so again, you know, how much material and how much, you know, stuff that we really needed, you know. When we came back, we were like, yeah, we don't really need that. You know, we can get by. And that's kind of how we live now is, you know, do we really need it, or are we going to be saving to do our next adventure, our next trip, you know?
Yeah. Okay. Well, you're a beautiful couple, and you have this passion for traveling, both of you, and this spirit of adventure. Do you think it's doable to do this trip also alone, or you need a travel partner to do it?
We've met so many people that were traveling alone.
Alone.
Yeah, and I think you're definitely able to join other like-minded people on the road. So, I mean, I would recommend it for anyone that wanted to travel, whether you're with someone else, or a friend, or by yourself.
It's just possible. Will you do it again? What are your plans for the future? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah.
Tell our followers a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, we would definitely do it again, and I think now we're already planning our next trip.
Yeah.
So we're just, I think, you know, for us, traveling is just part of our life and our passion, and it's something that we want to keep doing, you know?
Yeah.
So we're already getting ready for
you
our
are
next adventure.
Yeah. Thank you for being here, sharing with us your amazing experience. I'm pretty sure that it is and will be an inspiration for many of us. See you in the next nomadic experience.